Oh. He's playing as Fox, also. So it seems I'm the lighter colored one here. And I could just as well start on the, stuff I wanted to talk about. The chief among them being the polling, the namesake of the stream. Normally I hate this matchup, but I don't mind because I'm here to mostly get beat up. So, y'all like politics? Have you heard of this thing that we call politics? Many such cases. It is a thing that exists. And wouldn't you know it, there are news orgs that do polling that try to ascertain people's opinions. Except it's more complicated and less cool than that, as I will explore in a minute. I wanted to talk about a couple of recent polls and how they reflect badly on the concept of candidate polling. You know, like Trump versus Biden, whatever. Those polls particularly being the ones that showed Trump as either being ahead or being tied with Biden. Let me turn that down a little bit. So the first one, I'm gonna go in reverse order. The most recent poll was an ABC poll. The ABC poll had Biden behind Trump at, I think, or it was something like 43 to 52, something like that. Trump had a significant lead over Joe Biden in this poll, right? Then there was also a poll from CBS YouGov. That's the next most recent poll about this that I remember seeing, which had them, I think, statistically tied. It was like 50-49, Trump's favor or whatever, which is statistically that's them being tied. That's the second one, both in chronological and reverse chronological order. And then the third one, which is actually the least recent poll. This was, I think, the first major poll that people like looked at and had some discourse about. Was a New York Times poll, which showed Trump and Biden both tied at like 40 something, with a good chunk of people being like fence sitters or like undecided or something like that. Those are the three polls that I take issue with, right? All right, that guy one and done me. No biggie. Shout out to that guy. Has a good Fox. Let's start with the ABC poll, right? There are severe methodological flaws with all of these polls, but we'll go one by one, right? The NBC poll, first off, the NBC poll employed a big no-no in my eyes, which is their methodology relied only on landline phones. The poll where Trump was at like 52 and Biden was at 43 percent support, they only used landline phones. Now I'm gonna take a beat and ask, how many people use a fucking landline anymore? That's what I fucking thought. Nobody. That is a little bit hyperbolic framing. The people who are most likely to use landline phones are people above the age of 50, people who are my parents' age or older. And those people skew rightward, more so than the rest of the country. Right? So that's one. That's the most major flaw about this poll. They were effectively, by calling landline phones, ABC was only polling people like age 50 and older, which is a Trump stronghold demographic. That's the first major issue, and then there are some issues common to all three, but I'll get to that when I get to that. The CBS YouGov poll has a much more subtle flaw. First, I remember looking at this poll and really scrutinizing it in ways that I feel like a layperson wouldn't or might not even think to do. they didn't list the sort of party registration statistics of the people they interviewed, which is an essential part of having a poll that is actually indicative of anything, be it a leading indicator or a lagging indicator. Basically, they were like, oh, well, we interviewed a group of people that is, like, demographically speaking, as far as, like, ethnicity and religion is basically how America is constructed. But we're not going to tell you how many conservatives we interviewed for this versus how many left-leaning people we interviewed for this, right? And as it turns out, oh, this guy knows my Achilles heel. As it turns out, the reason they did that, the reason they didn't disclose this, is because of the way that they pre-select people to even be polled for questions at their organization. So for CBS, YouGov to even consider you for like these polling interviews and whatever, you might wonder why you never get these interviews. It's because they don't actually give these interviews to people. You have to specifically seek them out. What I mean by this is that you don't get to be part of a CBS YouGov poll unless you are literally a member of CBS YouGov on their cell phone app. And even then, the way the poll is done is not through the app. You have to fill out a physical sheet of paper with the questions on it. And now, the poll did mention how many people they interviewed. It was about 4,000. But that is out of a very small pool as far as like a nationally representative sample goes. Only about 20,000 people are on that list of people who are like eligible to be interviewed by CBS YouGov for stuff. So understand that when they say, oh, we interviewed 4,000 or 5,000 people for this, when CBS YouGov says that, they're picking from the same 20,000 people every time, which means that those people are going to be they're going to be, like, subject to certain factors that normal people are not. They're going to be, by definition, out of touch with the rest of the opinion of the United States here, you know? That's the CBS YouGov poll. So we have, so far, a poll that only asks old people for their polling questions, and then a poll that only asked the same group of 20,000 people for their poll every single time. Now we get back to an equally bad, I would say the worst offender, but I actually don't think that you could really say any of these are like the single worst offender. The New York Times poll, which had, it was like 43-43 Trump and Biden, and then like, I don't know, 14% of people undecided or something like that. And the methodological issue with this poll is that they essentially asked, they basically asked twice as many Republicans as they did Democrats, right? So where the CBS YouGov poll didn't list the ideological convictions of the people they asked, the New York Times poll made the mistake of listing the ideological convictions of the people they asked, which was about 60 to 30 something percent Republicans to Democrats, right? And then they asked a few independents as well. And that is the only way they were able to get that that result, that like Trump and Biden are actually kind of tied result. So from these three polls, we have a poll that only asked older people, a demographic that skews in the Republicans' favor, right? We have a poll that only asks the same 20,000 people every time, which is not representative of American political opinions. And we have a poll that asked a 2-to-1 ratio of Democrats to Republicans in order to find their answers. So those are the methodological issues that are specific to these polls. But as I'm going to explain in just a second here, this is not all what is wrong here. Because there's a much more severe and I think endemic issue to the concept of polling that I think should be talked about, right? And that is that polling is basically disinformation, right? And I say disinformation as opposed to misinformation. I used to say misinformation because I didn't want to assign intentionality where it wasn't due. But I think this the issues with polling constitute a like willful ignorance and a willful lack of understanding of the issue here. So I think everybody has probably at some point seen the headline of Dewey defeats Truman. You know, that's a pretty infamous newspaper article. This guy's a box fox, I'm just now realizing. Nobody else dash dances like that. So one of the reasons that polling is this cesspool of disinformation is it turns politics into this horse race, right? It trivializes politics. I'm sure you've seen this on like news outlets, the way they cover debates, the way they cover elections and stuff like that. Oh my God, who's in the lead? Who has momentum? This is sporting event talk. This is not like policy talk. This is not politics. This is horse race, right? And when you talk about politics like that, the way American like commentators do, you turn off large sections of your audience from participating, particularly like younger people, more disaffected people, and people who lie vaguely left of center. Now you might if you've seen my content, you might be getting shades of another video that I made where I talk shit about pollsters and polling. And that's because this is going to basically be the same arguments. You know, we have element number one, the trivialization of politics down to nothing more than a horse race. When, you know, people are looking for answers in their lives to very serious problems and grievances, and they see politics as a sort of game that people who are in some sort of social clique participate in. They're gonna, like, be less willing to consider that as a serious, like, avenue for addressing those grievances. Ah, DK. Right? Element number two, then. Oh, shit, he's ready to go. Element number two of why polls are disinformation, why they suck, why they're bad for democracy, even. I'll get to those arguments a little bit later. Is that these polls are not scientifically valid. So you usually hear about this in the context of, you know, political science. This is what political scientists do typically. They do candidate polling, they do issue polling, they do all sorts of stuff, right? But the methods of polling, as well as the margins on which they operate, the margins that, like, they say, oh, plus or minus this percent certainty, and the frequency with which polls actually produce results that are outside their or the degree to which polls fail to align with reality in a way that's actually outside of their margin of error, show that these polls are not scientifically valid. They are not, you know, they shouldn't be passing peer review. If peer review is worth anything, it shouldn't be letting any of these polls through. And it's not advancing the knowledge base in any significant way, if that makes sense. That's one way that they're not scientifically valid, is they can produce all sorts of errors. But then the other way, the main thing, is that they are done with haste, and they're also not done by any genuine desire to further the scientific mission of, like, understanding humanity and, you know, progressing the knowledge base, like I said. They are commercial ventures. When you see a CBS YouGov poll or a New York Times poll or 538 or whatever, those are not there for scientific advancement. Those are there for commercial purposes, right? The standards for a commercial poll and the standards for a scientifically valid and vetted poll are very different things. For, I would say for better or worse, but in this case for the worse. And what this does is it basically, it produces a veritable minefield, a very populated minefield of bad polls. Polls that are rushed, that are done for, mostly for like, for people to put on a resume to look good, for people to get clout within like the political consultant class, and that are basically a crapshoot as to whether they're any good. You know, they're meant for somebody to go on to CNN and tout their big brain prediction of this is how this was going to play out. Never mind the fact that polls, by definition, because they're an image of what people think right now, they cannot be a leading indicator. Polls are only capable of what's of being what's called a lagging indicator, which means like showing things that have already happened. A poll about Trump versus Biden right now is not going to in any way give an indication of what the 2024 election is going to be like, because it's a year out. This is indicative of what politics looked like last week, not what politics is going to look like a year from now, right? That's another element at play, is the sort of low fidelity and purposeful low fidelity of these polls that are being circulated on CBS and wherever else. You know, don't even get me started on like Rasmussen or whatever right wing org does their polling. But you know, they put up less of the mask, so I'm not as concerned with them at right now, because they also don't get taken as seriously even in polling circles. And then element number three. Now that I've established that these polls are scientifically not valid, are often incorrect, and trivialize politics, the effects of this is the next thing, is that it turns off mainstream, like, left-leaning people from going out and participating, and going out and voting, and things like that. Because of their perceived factual basis, whether that's real or not, which I believe it is very much not, what ends up happening is that you get left-leaning people who look at these polls, and they see like, oh, you know, it's like tied between Trump and Biden again, or whatever. They see a result that is like very doom-inspiring, because it's like the Republicans can tear apart democracy at the seams and threaten to put trans people in, like, conversion camps and stuff like that. And we can't even get, like, and that's not even enough to get, like, the opposing candidate a lead in the polls or whatever. Like, what's even the point? People are liable to see the speed at which polling outlets crank out inaccurate polls and the results of those polls, and like throw their hands up and be like, well, what the fuck is even the point? Why, what am I doing here, right? You know, it's a big club and I'm not in it, basically, is what sort of happens there. And now that brings me actually to the other side of this coin, which is right-wing people. You might be wondering if this is also a thing with right-wingers. And the thing is, no, it is not. It is only a thing for left-wingers, because left-wing people care about factual analyses of the situation. They're people on the left, more so than on the right, tend to have beliefs that are grounded in factual information about the world that we live in, right? People on the left, to give you a perspective, somebody on the left, like myself, could disapprove of Joe Biden, but then still recognize that he is the preferable choice and go out and vote for him. Meanwhile, the Venn diagram of people who support Trump and people who vote for Trump is a flat circle. They are the same thing. So a right-winger would see a poll that might otherwise dissuade them and be like, this is actually a deep state conspiracy by the media to prevent me from voting for Trump or whatever. And they would remain just as energized, and they would go and vote for Trump, and all that stuff, it would not affect them, but it would affect a mainstream liberal, or even a leftist, you know, like myself. I mean, not exactly like myself, you hear shit I'm talking about, polls, but you get what I mean, right? It hurts the left, and it helps the right. It helps fascism when there's such a disinformation network dedicated, it seems like, to muddying the waters between which political faction, between fascism and not fascism, is more compelling. You know, that emboldens fascists, and it weakens democracy because it it puts people in this sort of constant state of, like, the campaign's happening all the time, and you know, it very quickly sours people to participating in politics, right? So, for all of these things, right, we have these three polls that have severe flaws on their own, but then that also, like, have severe flaws that the rest of the polls share. Actually, there's one thing I forgot to mention, which is that, like, due to the speed at which pollsters put out polls, they know that they're bound to get some stuff wrong. And what they do is instead, like, muddy the waters and try to, like, obscure the fact that they were wrong one time by doing a scattershot approach of polling. 538 is very blatant about this, where they predict a bunch of different outcomes, some of them mutually exclusive, so that whatever happens, they can say, oh wow, guys, look how correct we were with this one poll. Never mind the fact that this was one scenario out of 100, and some of the things that we predicted were outright insane. Aren't we so smart and you know, politically in the know and whatever, right? Polling outlets will do that. So it has a similar effect, funnily enough, to Russia Today, you know, the Russian state TV. That's the most comparable example, you know, where to obfuscate the fact that, like, they're obviously peddling some shit that isn't correct, they'll just peddle every single thing. Every single narrative on a given, you know, election or whatever. And honestly, this got me really animated last time, and it might be difficult to tell. It might not seem this way because I'm a little bit more tired. It's later in the evening. But it has me really animated right now. And like, I understand that the immediate retort to some people who might be more proximal to these polling circles, or people who might subscribe to the sort of traditional knowledge or traditional wisdom or whatever, the retort from these people, I imagine, would be something like, you know, what do? Just stop polling? You know, stop asking people, like, who do you prefer, Trump versus Biden? Yeah, actually, that is exactly what we do. We don't need to fucking do that. You know, polls, if they exist at all, should be on a by-issue basis. They shouldn't be this, like, catty high school popularity contest bullshit. Pollsters who do this provide nothing to society. They are parasites because they're sapping resources that could otherwise be used for legitimately useful purposes. Think of all the kind of political science research and social science research that has been done on the impacts of certain policies, the very real impacts of policies on, like, marginalized communities or like, for certain avenues of research into, like, I don't know, mental health stuff, into different policies that could be taken that aren't currently, into, like, other countries, you know, comparative analysis, things like that. All of that is what you could be doing, but you're not doing if you do candidate polling and election polling like this. So yeah, actually, I have a message for those, you know, for those pollsters. Shut the fuck up. I don't want to hear another word about Trump versus Biden in the polls. I don't want to hear about it. You provide nothing to society, and I hate you, and I will beat you up, and I will also take your lunch money. Stop it. You're killing democracy. You've been killing democracy for a long time. Ever since you fucking did the you know, the poll of, oh, Dewey defeats Truman, and didn't learn your goddamn lesson? Yeah, no. You don't have a right to speak here. Might be. Or you do, but I will punch you. That is my take to all the political scientists out there, all the Nate Silver types who do this sort of election polling. All the rest of you, all the other political scientists that don't engage in this sort of thing regularly, I love you and you're beautiful. That is my message here.